Well, helping us provide insight into the global populist movement is Andrew Dowling. He's a contemporary historian working in the Hispanic Studies Department at Cardiff University. Andrew, thanks so much for joining us. First, what are some of the economic and social factors that you think contributed to a rise in populism around the world in the last few years?
Well, I think it goes quite deeply, really. I think for many people, really, since the late 1980s, life has been a kind of struggle. And that struggle was suspended because of credit. So people, you know, maxed the credit cards, as it were, for a couple of decades until the crisis hit. And once the crisis hit after 2008, that kind of pulled away that ability to survive anymore on credit. And that's a really important driver, but the kind of the roots of some of these things are quite deep in the political culture.
How has the pandemic impacted populism, specifically in countries like France and Brazil? They'll have elections in 2022, and those may be a referendum on where global populism is.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think we can see that the pandemic has produced a kind of response, really, on the part of populist movements, and we can almost call them COVID populists, who are, and we've seen, you know, demonstrations even in mainstream conventional countries like Germany against the restrictions on freedoms, against the restrictions on civil liberties. We've seen that a lot in the United States of America as well. So there's clearly a big issue around the crisis that is produced by COVID that can be a useful lever for populist movements in the years to come. I don't think we should be writing them off at all at the present time.
Have we seen an emergence of leftist populism in response to Trump's style of populism, economic populism, if you will? I mean, one could argue that people like Bernie Sanders may fall into that category, or Mexico's president, AMLO.
Yeah, we have, but it's so less effective than broadly right populism. In fact, you know, analysis of this has shown that probably about 88% to 90% of the populist movements defined as populist tend to be on the right of the political spectrum, and those on the left, you know, barely scrape 9%. So the left has, in broad terms, although, you know, Sanders had a decent run for a time in the American elections, in broad terms, the left marrying of populism doesn't seem that effective.
Do you predict that Donald Trump might be able to maintain a grip on the Republican Party after he leaves office? And if not, what happens to his brand of populism? Is there an obvious heir to it?
Well, I think, as your report rightly noted, he's got an incredibly loyal base. And I think we also have to remind ourselves that Donald Trump won the second highest number of votes ever in any American presidential election. American politics, rather, is highly polarized. Loyalty is incredibly intense to one side or the other, whether it's Republican or Democrat. We also see that American Republicans increasingly, you know, don't even see Democrats as you know, it's almost they talk in terms of them as being un-American. They're denying their Americanness. And that kind of polarization, that kind of division, clearly means that Donald Trump has got a few more years in him in terms of the political system. Remember, in just 2 years' time, there'll be midterm elections that will give Republicans, in a broad sense, the opportunity to regain control of the political agenda in the American political system.
When you look at some places like Hungary, like Viktor Orban and his Fidesz party, is it a rejection of liberalism? And it seems to be creating a problem in Europe in general, if it is.
Yeah, well, absolutely. One explanation of populist movements is that rejection of the traditional liberal, conventional mainstream political order. And in particular, that it's able to channel grievances felt by people who felt excluded or overlooked or ignored by those they term the elites. So clearly there's a clear division going on in Europe. It's small at present, but I think so much really is going to depend on the next 2 to 3 years. How successful are countries in terms of economic recovery? Do we see 2021 as a kind of bounce back, or are there real sectors of societies across the world clearly experiencing long-term damage to their, you know, personal economy, to their personal wealth, and so on? And that can clearly provide fuel, can provide an opportunity for populists to mobilize their grievances. There are different plates spinning, really, at the same time.
Andrew Dowling from Cardiff University, thank you so much for your insight.